I might say that it's an honor that we're co-sponsoring this conference today with the Ron Paul Institute. This is the first time in the entire history of the Mises Institute, as David Stockman asked me the other night, I said, have you ever done this before? I said, no. And David said, well, with these two organizations together, he said, I knew I had to be there. So all these speakers, of course, are just tremendous. The speech that I had originally planned became very quickly out of date. So I think I'm just going to take questions and answers today. I might just talk for a moment about how far back when some of these problems go. When we hear the word national security, national interest used by people in Washington, I always think it's important to substitute imperial for national. Then it all makes sense. So is it in the national interest of the United States to bomb Syria? No, it wasn't. Was it in the imperial interest of the American Empire to do so? Yes, very much so. Because every little jot and tittle on the map of the world might threaten the empire, since the U.S. feels, as the Romans did before them, and others, of course, besides the Romans, that really the U.S. is destined to rule the world. In the U.S.'s case, I guess, rule the solar system, too, with the colonies on Mars and the moon and so forth. So everything is of interest to them. Everything is important. And just as the state, even a dictatorial state, and by the way, the American president counts as a dictator if we were to judge him by the standards of the founding fathers. We call all these other guys dictators. To the founders, one of the key things about a tyrant was that he was able to declare war on his own. So, of course, we've had that for some time in this country. So the Romans were famous for their slogan, divide et impera, divide and conquer. We can put it in a more modern context, bring about chaos and control. So an empire, whether it was the Roman Empire or the American Empire or all the other empires, benefits from causing trouble. It prevents people from coalescing against it, keeps everybody off their feed, everybody wondering what the heck is going to happen next if they're in some part of the world where they might be attacked, being constantly subverted by the CIA and all the other intelligence agencies, which feel that is, you know, when we hear about the Russians faking news and so forth to control our elections, the CIA and the other intelligence agencies always intervene in other people's elections, always. We know about all the covert agencies. There's even an overt agency, the National Endowment for Democracy, whose open job is to interfere in other countries' elections to bring about democracy. Well, what is democracy? The democratic result is when the pro-American side wins. The side that is therefore that is going to be subservient to the U.S. empire, that's democracy. So we have an open organization. I never heard that mentioned, just strangely enough, during all the talk about the poor Russians. So the Romans, Schumpeter points this out in one of his articles on ancient Rome, that they had two themes. We are the most important. We bring civilization. We bring culture. We bring law. We are the greatest people ever to exist. We're destined, in fact, by the gods to rule forever. That's why Rome was called the Eternal City. Turned out not to be eternal, but that's what they felt. That's what they propagandized as. On the other hand, there was a constant drumbeat of, oh my gosh, the Germans are going to get us. The Gauls are going to get us. The whomevers are going to get us. Keep the people constantly in fear of being attacked, while the Romans, of course, were attacking everybody else. Garrett Garrett, the great old right journalist in the years before World War II, referred to America as having this complex of fear and vaunting. That is, we're the best, we're the most powerful, we're the richest, we're the greatest, we're the freest. USA number one, you know, and the finger and all that. Meanwhile, oh my gosh, they're going to get us. the Germans are going to get us, the Japanese are going to get us, the Russians are going to get us, whatever. There's always some enemy, the terrorists are going to get us. So it's important that it's exactly the same stories as the Romans. And part of this, it's always interested me as to who they're demonizing. When a country is being demonized, when a foreign leader is being demonized, and are these guys dictators? Are they dictators by founding father standards? Oh, yeah. Is the American president, again, a dictator by the founding father standards? Oh, yes. And in fact, he's the world dictator, not just a dictator of one regime. So I think it's always important to look at the people who are being demonized. Remember when Saddam Hussein was being demonized. And by the way, this was a very bad man. He actually, at U.S. behest, by the way, I should mention he was installed by the U.S. in power, the U.S. and the British, as the anti-communist dictator of Iraq, because they were concerned about having, of course, an Iraq that would be friendly to British then and U.S. interests. But he did something very, very evil. He started a war against Iran in which a million people were killed on both sides. And he received chemical weapons from the U.S. He received intelligence. He received vast amounts of money, weapons. It was a horrible thing he did. On the other hand, he's an interesting character. I remember just before the second Iraq war, when Michael Moore actually did something good. I know that's a little bit difficult to believe. He put out a movie called Fahrenheit 9/11. And I remember it being bitterly criticized at the time because he showed regular scenes of Iraq. He showed businesses. He showed mothers taking their children to the playground. He showed a very popular National Symphony Orchestra in Baghdad. Men and women, no women wearing burqas or scarves, by the way. If they wanted to, they could. They didn't have to. Playing classical music. Showed companies. Showed businesses. Notice how many pictures have you seen of Damascus? We're never shown pictures or anything that humanizes any country the U.S. has got in the crosshairs. So Saddam Hussein, I don't know, I always thought it was interesting that when he knew he was going to be attacked, he opened all the collections of weapons of the government and handed them out to anybody who wanted them. And I thought, well, that's an unusual thing for a dictator to do. He was pro-Christian, something else that Assad is guilty of. He protected the Christians. He was from a minority tribe, which is typically how these countries work when you've got huge splits between tribes of Sunnis and Shias and the tribes not entirely. There are many tribes within both these groups. It's a very complex picture. So he was always in a balancing act. But part of the balancing act, and I don't think it was out of the goodness of his heart, although who knows, he was pro-Christian. He prevented the Christians from being ethnically cleansed and killed, as has happened ever since the U.S. intervened in Iraq, maybe just by coincidence, maybe not by coincidence. I always thought it was interesting. I couldn't watch the whole thing, but there was famously a tape made of Saddam Hussein's execution. And as he's walking to the gallows where he's going to be hanged, he was very calm, dignified. And I thought at the time, I wonder if George Bush, in a similar circumstance, would be calm and dignified as he's about to be executed. So it's just an interesting point that doesn't seem to go along with what we're told about Assad. I've always thought it was interesting that Assad did not want to be in politics. He was educated in England in ophthalmology. He was a practicing ophthalmologist in London. Left Syria, and it was only the death of his older brother in a car accident. And his father's pleading that brought him back. And I think he must often wish the heck he were still an ophthalmologist in London, because of course he's being threatened with being Gaddafiized. And he has a beautiful family. They would all be killed as well. But he's a very interesting figure. Do you ever see him? Are there ever any, one time there were a few interviews with him. Why aren't there interviews with him? Why isn't he allowed to speak his piece? Never. Why aren't there pictures of what life is like in the areas of Syria that have not been destroyed by the U.S. or by its, how shall I say, cohorts, ISIS and Al-Qaeda? Very, very suspicious relationship between the U.S. and ISIS and Al-Qaeda. Mujahideen, as was pointed out earlier, were in effect Al-Qaeda, financed by the U.S., brought together by the U.S. to fight the Russians in Afghanistan. This is where Osama bin Laden first came to prominence and his role in that fight. So empires are happy, maybe all governments being, not being a pro-government guy myself, maybe all governments are happy to employ these kinds of evil forces to bring about the chaos that then enables them to go say, hey, we're bringing civilization. We're the ones. And you can trust us. Turns out, of course, you can't trust the U.S. We can't trust the U.S. government ever. We can't trust the U.S. government domestically because it aims to destroy every institution that stands against it, whether it's the family, the community, the business, the charity, the church. Government is against them all. That ought to give us a clue about what's going on in the rest of the world. You just can't trust them. You can't believe them. And it's always important not to believe them. I always love the old British expression, never believe anything until it's been officially denied. Maybe sometimes government officials and politicians tell the truth. I exempt, of course, Ron Paul, who was the great truth teller. So these are very interesting times. What Trump did is unfortunately, obviously not what he promised in his election. Was it entirely a fraud? One of my favorite bloggers, Bionic Mosquito, said, did he wake up with a horse's head in his bed? You know, what exactly happened? He also said he was turned by the deep state even faster than Reagan, and he said this time they didn't have to use a bullet. So Reagan became very compliant. I don't think Reagan actually had some interesting ideas about the gold standard and other things that just immediately disappeared after he was shot. Trump has been conquered again, or was he? Was it always... You know, who knows? We'll see. Maybe there's still some good to be had there. He's already done a few good regulatory things, but most of it, of course, has been bad. But all the U.S. presidents, when was the last time we had a half-decent U.S. president? Herbert Hoover was a great man of peace, post-World War II, for example, tried to bring about peace during his administration, but a total disaster as president domestically. He was really responsible for the start of the New Deal. Roosevelt just continued his work, Hoover's work, which was based on Woodrow Wilson's work, setting up really the first fascist economy in American history, made perpetual by Franklin Roosevelt during his administration. So we can't trust these people. So. Let me just end there and see if any of the bouncing balls want to ask a question here. Yes.
We all know the UN has never met a foreign invasion they didn't approve of, but the European Union hasn't really fully jumped on board with it yet. How do you think their role will play out as this continues?
Well, the European Union, of course, very interesting organization. As we now know, set up at least at the behest of, or certainly with the cooperation and the urging of the CIA, maybe it was more than that. On the other hand, U.S. opposition has kept them from having their own army and their own military otherwise, which I think is a benefit. But on the other hand, you have NATO vastly expanded. NATO not there. Mr. Trump, when he talks about, hey, they owe us more money than we're spending too much money defending them. Obviously, the U.S. is not defending anybody in Europe. The U.S. is occupying Europe. The U.S. has got atomic bombs all over Germany. If your next door neighbor has got an atomic bomb in your backyard and he asked you for something, you may be inclined to do it. So the EU, I must say, I despise the EU. I hate the EU. I hope it goes out of existence. But I think there are some pro-peace people in Europe, not the evil Angela Merkel or Juncker or the rest of the people in the belly of the beast, the direct belly of the beast. But the Europeans have been hurt by the U.S. anti-Russian sanctions, dramatically hurt. Businesses in Germany and France, all over Europe, which used to do a tremendous amount of very profitable business with the Russians, have been hurt, and there as a result, there's pressure against that. On the other hand, they must be afraid themselves of being bombed if were they to remove the sanctions. And this, of course, was put on during the Obama administration, and quite terrible. Sanctions, as Ron Paul reminds us, are only, of course, not a violation of free trade, not only a violation of free trade, but they're acts of war under international law. It's an act of war. I mean, those of us old enough to remember the boycott, the oil boycott in the 70s, people were very angry. They were angry at the countries that were doing that because it had a bad effect here. Now, the real reason it had a bad effect here was the U.S. government, which set up the rationing scheme that ended up with, I was living in Oklahoma City at that time, ended up with Oklahoma City being awash in gasoline, I'm not complaining about that, and other parts of the country, you know, having none. Of course, it was a crazy quilt and a horrible system, but everybody was angry at those Arabs who had caused this. Well, at the worst thing, if the Arabs had simply asking more money for their oil, it would have raised the price here. But it would not have led to a shortage. Anytime there's a shortage of anything, it means the government is involved. As Murray Rothbard used to say, there's no shortage of Rembrandts. If you want to buy a Rembrandt, you can buy a Rembrandt. You got to have the market price, obviously. So, but sanctions make people very angry, rightly angry. They seek to impoverish people. They're immoral. It's an attack on civilians. If we think of the most rigorous of the just war criteria, that war was supposed to be what Mises said, it was supposed to be a war of the soldiers. It was not supposed to involve civilians. Now, of course, in all wars, civilians are the vast majority of the dead and wounded. Vast majority. In a lot of these countries, it's far safer to be a soldier than to be a civilian. Is this by happenstance? No, I don't think it is. I think it's deliberate. Hans Hoppe would tell us that it has to do with the emergence of democratic war in World War I and the rest, and really starting with the American Civil War. Lincoln began it all, like so much other evil stuff. And Wilson and the British picked it up. The British, of course, always being, if anything, worse than the U.S. as imperialists and spies and so forth. But the idea that really everybody is a legitimate target. If you're working in a factory, you might be making munitions. If you're delivering milk, why you're enabling the workers of munitions, the makers of munitions and so forth, so that everybody can be killed. And in fact, as during World War II, the U.S. engaged in massive bombing of all cities of Germany and Japan, deliberately killing millions of civilians. Collateral damage, you know, those are just words. So I hope the people of the EU, the good people of the EU, and there are many great people of the, and the wonderful movements that are against the EU and tend to be peace movements. I was very glad to see Nigel Farage, the great leader of Brexit, condemn this attack on Syria. And that's the way I think a lot of, according to the London Telegraph, that's the view of all the right-wing populists, so-called, in Europe. They don't like war. They don't like intervention. They really have many libertarian things about them. So there's always hope, but there's only hope in saying no, in thinking no, in withholding your consent from these people, not in worshiping the military, not in worshiping the agencies of government, not in worshiping the government, not in worshiping politicians. We have to withdraw, withhold, create our own values based on our own religions, our own love of freedom, and not pay any attention. I don't say there's anything wrong with watching the media, although I was influenced some years ago by a great article that argued that watching Fox lowered your IQ. But of course, if you watch these channels and you believe them, you have, you know, your certainly your stock of knowledge is devalued and lowered, of actual knowledge. Because of course, they're all fake news. It's supposed to be, I was very glad to have LewRockwell.com put on the list of fake news sites, the 200 fake news sites. But fake news is stuff the government doesn't want you to hear. Government doesn't want you to believe these things. You're not supposed to read it. And we have Google and Facebook, of course, cooperating with the suppression of this so-called fake news. And on the other hand, as Daniel pointed out, there still is great things going on among young people and among social media. I'm told, I did not see this myself, that trending on Twitter, number one yesterday and today, was the hashtag Fire Jared Kushner. So that's not exactly, of course, the kind of thing we hear in public. And I don't think we should maybe draw any conclusions from the fact that Mr. Kushner, the son-in-law and most powerful advisor to President Trump, owns an office building at 666 Fifth Avenue. So interesting. Sorry, any more? Oh, Professor Butler Schaefer?
Your including remarks that reminded me of the old Eisenhower-Stevenson presidential. They weren't debates, they were just speeches. And they were being shown at a particular mental hospital, and the hospital custodians had to turn them off because it was so upsetting to the patients. I've long really been interested in this division, or not division, the contrast between individual thinking and the kind of collective groupthink that has been alluded to today. And I think that the strength of either of these approaches, individual thought versus group thought, either creates civilizations or destroys them, and I think that may be where we are right now. Randolph Bourne addressed this, I think, when he talked about the power of war to transform individual thinking into the advocacy of policies and programs none of them would think of doing individually. And when there's talk that began, I think, with the Clinton administration and carried over into the Bush administration about impeachment, I did an article suggesting that maybe it's the American people that should be impeached because they haven't really performed the task, which I think is a burden upon all of us, to question those who would presume to rule us. I have long been of the view that people, men and women, have a moral duty to prevent their children from being ruled by tyrannies. I was wondering if you have any thought on that.
Well, I couldn't agree with you more, and I just you reminded me of a point that the late Joe Sobran made when he was opposing the war in Iraq. He said, imagine that they would put a 7-year-old Iraqi little girl on television and say, what we're going to do is we're going to stab her to death. If you are willing to go to war, this is going to be the start. And of course, everybody would be horrified. How could you say such a thing? What a horrible event. And yet, of course, there were going to be so many thousands, perhaps hundreds of thousands of Iraqi little girls who died through the American sanctions and then through the wars. 500,000, if we remember, Iraqi children died because of the sanctions and the evil Secretary of State. Albright was asked about it, and she said, we think it's worth it. And I thought, you... Yeah. Yeah. Especially because Mrs. Albright could use a little sanctions herself, I must say. And
do we have time, David, for one more question?
One more question?
Okay. Lew, several times in your remarks, you mentioned the word chaos. I think it was very appropriately mentioned. In this environment where we're inundated daily with the competing propaganda from very skilled propaganda machines, the search for truth becomes very difficult. You mentioned several years ago in a Mises Circle event a story that came out of the Soviet Union in its waning years about a party official who was traveling through the countryside in his big car, had a flat. And the locals tried to help him fix the flat, open the trunk, salamis all over the place. They couldn't get those. They almost beat him to death or something like that.
Yeah.
You mentioned that in our time, the internet may serve that same purpose as the salamis in that trunk. What do you think currently about the possibility? The internet is so full now of competing propaganda. The search for truth is difficult.
It is, but
you can update us on your opinion.
But the internet has made it possible. I'll tell you, it was very, very difficult before the internet. You had to have access to a big international newsstand, for example, in your city, where you could get foreign papers and foreign publications, some of which you could subscribe to. No way in heck you could afford to subscribe to all of them. And you had American publications, but they tended to be very obscure. So it's much easier. So it's still very difficult. But I'll just mention the great Eric Margolies, who unfortunately, tragically couldn't be here for this conference, but he has a very interesting column today on lewrockwell.com called Bomb the Usual Arabs. And in it, he talks about, he thinks that at least part of what was going on, and that's been mentioned earlier too, was the humiliation of President Xi of China. Here he is arriving at Mar-a-Lago, I guess we have to call it War-a-Lago now, to have dinner, which is already, he's in a supplicant position that he's doing that. And then he's totally humiliated by his ally, Syria. Can't forget, China is an ally of Syria too. And Margolies says, Trump is lucky he didn't just leave, take his plane back and go because of this horrendous insult to him. So this was an insult. This is, again, all part of the imperial strategy of there are really only two countries in the world that don't bow to the U.S., that don't bow the knee to the U.S., at least on some things. That's Russia and China. So who are the two places we're supposed to hate? Who are the two places we're supposed to be ready to go to war for? Eric points out we're supposed to go to war with China because they've turned some atolls in the South China Sea into military bases. He said, how is that any different from the U.S. aircraft carriers patrolling those same areas that are all, just in effect, roving military bases? Some years ago, I saw an article by Bill Kristol denouncing the Chinese. He said the Chinese seek to be the important power in the South China Sea. I thought, that's pretty horrible. It's like somebody accusing the U.S. of seeking to be the major power in the Gulf of Mexico. But of course, if you understand that according to the official ideology, we are the exceptional nation, not only are we the greatest, the best, the richest, and all the rest of it, even though, of course, a lot of that's not true. The rules don't apply to us. In fact, not only do the rules not apply to us, we make the rules. We impose the rules, and you better obey. So China and Russia are not obeying, therefore they must be crushed. Both these, of course, countries have thermonuclear weapons, and it's really why this is a very scary thing. Thank God for Ron Paul, who's our next speaker.